In today's video, we will talk about 8-bit AVR microcontrollers and how we can write our program into them. This program can be, for an example, a simple blink program, a firmware for your 3D printer, or just a bootloader to make it easy to write our program to the microcontroller. In this video series, I will use Arduino Mega, Arduino Uno, Arduino Nano, USB ASP, USB ISP, motherboard from Ender 3, motherboard from Anet A8, motherboard from Anet A8 Plus, and as a bonus, Raspberry Pi. Some devices will be used as programmers, and some of them as storage devices to which we will write our program. All of these devices, except Raspberry Pi, contains 8-bit AVR microcontroller. AVR is a family of microcontrollers developed since 1996 by Atmel, acquired by Microchip Technology in 2016. AVR was one of the first microcontroller families to use on-chip flash memory for program storage, as opposed to one-time programmable ROM, EEPROM, or EEPROM used by older microcontrollers at the time. A lot of motherboards was built on this kind of cheap microcontrollers. For an example, ATmega 2560 is mostly known from motherboards like MKS Gen L, ANSYRAMBO from Prusa MK3, or as a combination with RepRap Arduino Mega Pololo Shield, or RAMPS for short. Another really used microcontroller is ATmega 1284P, which can be found on cheap motherboards like this one from Anet A8, this one from Anet A8 Plus, or this one from Creality Ender 3 and Ender 3 Pro. To program these microcontrollers, you can use many different methods. We will talk only about two of them. The first method is bootloader. Bootloader is a tiny program stored in a memory of the microcontroller that starts whenever a device is powered on or when the reset of the microcontroller is triggered. This program can do what we want, but mostly it listens on a serial port for a few seconds, waiting for some incoming bytes with instructions. If nothing is arriving, it loads the main program. If something is arriving, the bootloader reads these bytes, builds pages of them, and one page after another writes to the flash memory after that bootloader. When all data are written, it responds to the programmer and triggers the reset. This bootloader is the magic thing which allows you to write your program easily into your microcontroller's memory via USB with a little help of some USB to serial converter like FT232 or CH340. Without the bootloader, you will need to use another method. With this another method, you can avoid the bootloader and write directly your program. It will save some memory space. The bootloader will take a space between 256 bytes to 4 kilobytes, which is not a lot, but on some devices it can be kinda problem. This depends on your microcontroller and the size of the program you are trying to fit in. For an example, ATmega 2560 has 256 kilobytes, and almost all motherboards with this microcontroller come with a bootloader. ATmega 1284P has 128 kilobytes, which is half of ATmega 2560. This is the main reason why almost no motherboard with this microcontroller has a bootloader. If you have easy access to your motherboard and do not change the program too often, you can avoid the bootloader and use the older method to write only your program. Without the bootloader, you will have to use another method, doesn't matter what. Before I tell you the second method, I have to thank to everyone who contributed to the existence of this YouTube channel and to everyone who supports me in what I do. Today I would like to thank some of them. Today's chosen ones are Adam Koudelka, Jakub Kellner, Kellnis3D, Martin Dubnický and Michal Beňo. Thank you guys. The second method is in-system programming, also called in-circuit serial programming. Thanks to this method, we can write a program to our microcontroller without removing the microcontroller from the device. This programming method is functionally performed through SPI with some twiddling on the reset line. Many devices are prepared for this method and contain an ISP connector. This connector uses 10 or 6 pins, but in most cases you will need a 6-pin header connector. On this diagram you can see a pin number 1 in a small square. This pin helps us to understand how we have to attach the programmer. Also, it's good to know where are located pins for ground and positive supply voltage. This can help us place the connector correctly if we cannot recognize the position of the pin number 1 and avoid damaging our microcontroller we want to program. If you have a voltmeter, you can use it to determine the orientation of the ISP connector. The easiest way is to have a look for a ground plane and try to find the ground pin of the ISP connector. In case of printed circuit boards, a ground plane is a large area of copper foil on the board which is connected to the power supply ground contact and serves as a return path for current from the different components on the board. Now let's take a look at our devices and see how the ISP connector is located on them. Let's start with USB ASP and USB ISP. Both devices have pins described, so we will look at their reduction from 10 to 6 pins. And because here are the pins also described, we can move on the older device. If we look at this Arduino Mega board, we can see a label for the pin number 1. Let's pretend we don't see this label. Right now it's for us important to find ground pin of the ISP connector. This pin will be connected to some large copper area. The only pin looking as described is this one. Using this pin we can recognize the position of other pins. And this is how the pin layout looks from the top of the motherboard. Next one is Arduino Uno. Again, we look for the ground pin of the ISP connector. After turning the board, we can notice that this pin is attached to a larger copper area and these holes that lead to the other side of the board. After turning the board back, it is nicely to see that these holes are marked as ground. Using this pin, we can again recognize the position of other pins. Next board is Arduino Nano. Again we can see a label for the pin number 1, but we will ignore it. After turning the board, I see that one pin has a small square under it. This tells us that this is a pin number 1. We will again ignore it and try to locate the ground pin of the ISP connector. This pin is connected to a larger copper area than other pins, which should correspond to the ground pin. Next, I see this pin leading to this hole. After turning the plate, I see that the hole is marked as reset. Thanks to this information, we can recognize the position of the other pins. Let's check a little different motherboard. Here I have a motherboard from 3D printer Ender 3 and Ender 3 Pro. The ISP connector is right here between the USB and the EXP1 connector. After turning this motherboard and looking at the ISP connector, I see that only this pin is connected to a noticeable large copper area. Using this pin, we can recognize the position of the other pins. After rotating the motherboard, the pin layout will look like this. Now, I have here a motherboard from 3D printer Anet A8. The ISP connector pins are only those pins inside the J3 connector. We turn the board and look at these pins. After turning the board, I see that one of these 6 pins is connected to a really large copper area that leads to the power connector to the negative contact. Using this pin, we can again recognize the position of other pins. Last board is a motherboard from 3D printer Anet A8 Plus. Its connection is identical to the previous model. Again, the pins of the ISP connector are only those pins inside the J3 connector. After turning the board, I see that one of these 6 pins is connected to a really large copper area. At the same time, I see another pin that is connected to the 5V pin of this USB connector. Using these pins, we can again recognize the position of the other pins. Two tips for simplifying your work. Tip number 1. Connect the board to the power supply and use the voltmeter to measure voltage on the ISP connector. Just 2 pins will give you 3.3 or 5 volts, which will directly tell you where are the ground and positive supply voltage pins. If you see negative results, swap probes and you will see positive results. Just be careful not to connect some pins together. It can have terrible consequences. Tip number 2. Be lazy, use Google. Just write name of your board and ask for ISP pinout. You see? It was that easy! In today's episode, we learned something about microcontrollers we are using and 2 methods how we can program them. If you want to know how to program them and which tools you have to use, wait for the next episode. I hope you enjoyed the video and found it useful. If yes, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel. If not, leave your thoughts in the comments below. If you want to support this YouTube channel, you can do it by clicking on the links below the video. Thanks for watching. See you next time, and remember that even impossible is possible.